But why would you go?
Are you Simon Cowell?
What?
Charlotte Church, voice of an angel, liver of a wino.
Yesterday, Neil Mottram won gold for Australia in basketball. Today, can brother Craig make it a golden double for the Mottram family?
The men's 1500-metre final. Two favourites, depends on where you come from. Nick Willis, one of them. Well, Andy Baddeley going for England. He's got a good chance, as has the other English athlete, Nick McCormack. We'll see him shortly. They've both got a chance of a medal here. Very competitive next race, I think, is the best word to describe it. Mark Fountain. Well, I bet he'll fancy his chances Mark as well. Fountain. Well, as we go down the line, I'll just bring Brendan in, because the other guy I haven't mentioned is Craig Mottram. All of the Australians will be hoping that he can go one better than he did in the 5,000. But Nick Willis, a big danger. The English guys are a danger. Kenya, as always, there, thereabouts. A really difficult race to predict. Tactics, as ever, I would like to think, in the 1,500, important.
The tactics are hugely important, which is why there's been an arrangement made between the English athlete, Nick McCormack, and his training partner out here, and Blinko of New Zealand, and also Craig Mottram, and they've decided to try and share the pace between them. The idea is that Adrian Blinko takes the first 400 metres, then Nick McCormack takes over for 400 metres, and then the big effort by Craig Mottram to try and run the race all the way. Well, it's interesting to have these plans before races, but sometimes they go out the window. But essentially, these athletes are trying to make this a hard and a fast run race, to try and eliminate some of the fast finishers and make it a race in this stadium. As we look at Adrian Blinko, the man who's agreed to take the first lap here. They've been training together for the last couple of weeks out here in New Zealand, him and McCormack and Mottram. They've been racing against one another, but this is a traditional Commonwealth Games list. Three Australians, three Kiwis, two Englishmen, two Canadians, and two Kenyans, and it is a very wide open race. But this crowd in this stadium tonight are ready to witness. You can already see the cameras flashing as they line up, but it's going to be a fascinating race. You wouldn't like to predict the winner, but you'd like to predict that it's going to be a race where we look back on and say that was a race that was worthy of this stadium.
It was Ron Delaney who surprised everybody in 1956 in the Olympic final. John Landy, the big Australian favourite. Craig Mottram, the big favourite here tonight. And those plans that Brendan was talking about are all designed to try and run the legs off Nick Willis. And I know he's carrying all of the support from New Zealand, the traditions of Peter Snell and John Walker and the metric mile.
On your mark.
They all think he can do it. All of Australia thinks Mottram can do it. 1,500 metres, classic event at any major championship, and we could get a real classic race here. Now, the script, as we've been told, is that Blinko goes to the front, and coming around the outside, here he is, and Nick McCormack's waiting for him and is looking for him. It's Hamblin who's there for New Zealand as well. Now, this is a little bit slower than expected, and now Blinko just trying to maybe go at the front. And Nick McCormack doesn't want to do too much running for everybody else, but there he goes. Blinko, McCormack and Mottram, as you said.
Well, this race has been won by some of the great middle distance runners of all time. Roger Bannister won it, Herb Elliott won it, Peter Snell from New Zealand, and then Kip Kino won it. Steve Cram sitting next to me won it twice, and Peter Elliott won it. And last time around, Michael East won it. This time, we'd love to see an Englishman win it. We might see an Australian win it, but the New Zealanders, this has been an event where they've been very happy and very comfortable. 59 seconds for the first lap. Peter Snell, the great New Zealander, has said that he fancies Willis to win this race. Willis is in a very good position, just on the shoulder of Nick McCormack.
Willis beat Craig Mottram recently at a big race. Wanganui, the great grass track that Peter Snell once broke the world record on, and he outkicked Mottram in the home straight. Mottram wants to burn that finish off. Andy Baddeley's running an excellent race so far. He probably is aware of some of the plans and will try and follow Mottram like everybody else. And Baddeley has been running very, very well, and he will be looking at a medal here. Kevin Sullivan from Canada on the outside, still performing very well in championship races. He's got a fearsome kick. And Nick McCormack, well, he's leading them. It's not fast. He's out there in front. Willis looking behind. Where is Mottram? Right there. Badley's there. Oh, he's not. He's gone. He's just fallen. Craig Mottram's gone down as well.
Well, they moved out. They looked for some space. There was no space available. Nick McCormack is in a safe position out there in the lead. And Mottram's up back on his feet, but he's out of the race completely. Well, that was a real error of judgment on somebody's part there. When we see the action replay, we'll realise it. But Nick McCormack has been left out in the front. Willis is ready to go next to him. And it's really now, it's a different plan, but the best laid plans sometimes go like this.
Willis had a good look round. He doesn't know what to do now, Willis, because Mottram's catching up. Now, the effort he's had to make to catch up, there's no chance for him on this last lap, because once the burn-up starts, it will be a big burn-up. But I think it was the Kenyan. I think it was Jonathan Coleman who caused the problem. We'll have a look at it later. Certainly one of them. There goes Willis. Nick McCormack trying to respond, and Badley's not there. And Willis must be thinking, goodness me, I wasn't expecting this. Somebody else should have been making the pace at this point. He's feeling very easy, and he's stretching away, Nick Willis of New Zealand.
Well, that 100-metre split, 13.2 seconds when Willis went. He's opened up a gap. McCormack's in second place on the inside, trying to respond. But the race, the plans have all gone awry. And now it's every man for himself. Who's got the speed? Who's got the strength into the finishing straight?
Well, Willis needs to kick again because they're coming. Nate Brannan is there. Nick McCormack's still there for England. But Willis has got something left in the tank, and he kicks away again. Willis of New Zealand. They'll be jumping up and down watching this. Adds his name to that of Peter Snell, John Walker, great New Zealand miler, gold for them. Nick McCormack just ran out of the medals, Nate Brannan of Canada got there. Goodness me, what a dramatic race. And poor Craig Mottram. Well, the Australian crowd almost in stunned silence watching this.
Well, absolutely, Stephen. We don't exactly know what happened. We do know that Mottram was getting ready to move out. He was tripped from behind. And Andy Badley coming down the finishing straight now, not able to be part of it. But here they go. Willis kicks with 400 metres to go, and he's opened up that gap. Well, he beat Mottram earlier this season. We knew he was going to be a danger. The whole of New Zealand wanted to win this race again. Nick McCormack in third place there, but coming under pressure. Brannan on the outside, and then the other New Zealander comes through, and there's a bump and a bore there, but Nick Willis, the man that beat Mottram earlier this season, opens his arms. New Zealand win this race again. It's been an awful long time, 1962, and we look here, there's Mottram in third place. Badley's just behind him. Now Mottram moves out. Badley gets tripped from behind, bumps into Mottram. Mottram's flat on the track. Blinko's on the inside of the field, and Nick McCormack, who was waiting for Mottram to come past him, is now left exposed at the front. Nick Willis of New Zealand. 1962, the great Peter Snell won this one. They've waited an awful long time. Let's hope this is the beginning of a resurgence. Nick McCormack of England is doing everything he can. Brannan is working hard there, and Hamblin of New Zealand, he realises there's a medal for him. McCormack comes under pressure, but Willis looked comfortable, looked easy. And he looked as though he had that one from an awful long way out. When he kicked at the bell, there was no response. And now if you look back, just let's see in a bit more detail. There's Mottram in the yellow vest. Badley's right behind him. On the inside is the New Zealander Blinko. And then suddenly, down goes Badley. He's tripped from behind. He brings down Mottram. So the problem was caused by the Canadian behind. It was an accident in running. That's what happens in distance running on the track. And Andy Badley is much worse for wear, and Mottram's out of the race.
Well, that's especially sad for Andy Badley. You can see Andy Badley has a cast on his arm. He fell at the 3 years indoors and broke his wrist. I don't know whether he looked in a lot of pain there, and obviously he may have aggravated that even more. That's why that plaster cast is on there. So for Andy Badley, it must be a sense of deja vu there. And as you're saying, Brent, possibly Sullivan just stepped on his heel, and then when he took Mottram down, then all of their chances went at that point. Willis, though, I thought he'd panicked at first. I thought he'd looked around. He didn't do anything for a while. And then when he kicked hard at the bell, I thought maybe he'd kicked a little bit too hard. And they were coming at him, but he'd saved a little bit for the home straight. So he would have figured at the end. Let's not take anything away from him. Willis was always going to be in with a shout of winning the gold medal along with Mottram. It was going to be tough for Mottram to beat this very, very talented New Zealander. So he's a worthy gold medalist. but not the type of race we wanted to see.
Well, if you just look at this with 400 metres to go there, McCormack leading, then suddenly Willis just absolutely takes off. Round the bottom bend there, he's flat out, he's sprinting. 13.2 seconds for that 100 metre split round the bottom bend. And then he levels up into the straight. He's running so hard. Nick McCormack is working extremely hard there down the back straight. But look at the gap that's opened up in 100 metres. 13.8 seconds for the 100 metres down the back straight for Nick Willis. And he's gathered himself again. He's picked himself up again. And then 200 metres to go. Willis realises they're chasing him. And round this top bend, once again, he's flat out. He's sprinting. 13.2 seconds for the top bend. And the race for the minor medals is on. But the victory for Nick Willis into the straight. He's really tired. He's beginning to slow. The field are coming back at him. 14.2 seconds for the last 100 metres for Nick Willis. But the damage is already done. And the battle there for the minor medals. Hamblin just hanging on there, just being outleaned by the Australian. And Nick McCormack, after being left in the front, very sadly for him, in fifth place.
Oh, goodness me. A dramatic evening so far at the MCG. Gold for New Zealand, Nick Willis, 338.49. Nate Brannan for Canada with the silver. Mark Fountain just sneaked in there to stop New Zealand getting another medal. He took the bronze for Australia. Nick McCormack, as Brennan said, fifth. And then we can look further down, and Craig Mottram picked himself up and ran round, and so indeed did Andy Bradley. Well, those things happen. You just have to accept it.
Yeah, have to, but an eventful evening. Australia dropped the bat. That happens
then. And it's part of sports, it's what happens, and it's unfortunate. And as Colin said, I mean, you've got 80,000 people in here expecting a great night. You know, things happen, as we talked about in the 4x100 meters.
Grishenkov, European champion, second in the European Championships in 1982. There's a more famous Russian which has come over to Australia, Viktor Saneyev, one of the all time greats of the event. But certainly good technique there from Olwin Jones. Slightly reminiscent, actually, of Christian Olsen. Oh, he improves. 16 metres, 65, third place.
Well, every time an Australian sets foot on this track, the MCG goes wild. This is William Hamlin Harris. Finished fourth in 2002. We're in the fifth round now, and it's still England's gold medal. Dropped his arm a little bit, but it was so aggressive, and once again somebody is making life a little bit dangerous for Nick Nealand. Nealand has led ever since round one. Not a huge throw, certainly not in the region of Steve Backley's 86 metres back in 1990, or in 1998, come to that. Marius Corbett, games record holder, 88-75, but it's been a very keenly fought competition. I just wonder if this guy has put himself in the frame. I think he's going to get a medal with that distance. It's 79 metres, 89, and for the time being, Harris has got a bronze.
The other individual track final tonight is the men's 10,000 metres. Abuya not starting, the man who finished a very good fourth in the 5,000 at the beginning of the week, would have been a threat here. Aish from New Zealand, Kipengeno from Kenya, Lusato from Tanzania, Kiprop from Uganda, Fabian Joseph, Tanzania, Gavin Thompson going for England, and Wilson Busiene for Tanzania, and Marwa and Paul Langat of Kenya. The Tanzanians have got three athletes. Kenya should have had three athletes. Uganda with two good athletes as well. So the threat from Africa very much in evidence again. Aish, Kipengeno, then Lusato from Tanzania, perhaps the favourite though, Boniface Kiprop wearing 2147, the Ugandan just out of the medals at the World Championship and the World Championships, excuse me, on the Olympic Games. Fabian Joseph, often seen those two together. Two very good juniors, now two very good seniors. Gavin Thompson for England as well. 25 laps of the track, as usual, and more of the mere contenders as they get underway. Oh, I think we might have a false start. Would hate them to run 1 inch less than they have to. Here we go then. So not a big field, but a very good high-quality field here. One or two athletes we know very well. We've seen them competing in major championships regularly. As I said, Boniface Kiprop certainly will start as the favourite, but one or two unknown quantities in here as well. With three Tanzanians, two from Uganda, two from Kenya. It'll be interesting to see whether they work together, whether there's a plan out there to go after a particular time, or whether just going to wait and see how things develop.
Well, you look at this race here ahead of us and you realize the African effect in distance running. No Australians, no Canadians, no Scots, no Welsh, one Englishman, one New Zealander, and basically the idea of the Africans have had such an effect on this event. A lot of the distance runners from the rest of the world have decided that they can't take them on. The only event of the whole championships where Australia haven't had an entrant, and that's a bit disappointing because they've been running well on the roads at the marathon. They've done well at other events too, in the 5,000 and shorter distances. But the Africans here this time, Uganda, well represented, Tanzania well represented, and the Kenyans less represented. One of the athletes we thought maybe one of the favourites here, Joseph Abuya, who finished fourth in the 5,000 metres in 13 minutes and 5 seconds, has decided not to take part in this one. And the early leader, Gavin Thompson of Crawley, formerly the English under 17 cross country champion, his best time of 28 minutes and 40 seconds. I'm sure when he comes here, down here, the idea of running a personal best would be one that would suit him. He'd like that idea. He'd like the opportunity to run well. And he's looking comfortable in the front. He's running a better pace than they were running earlier. So that's the wise move for the moment.
Well, it was a fairly pedestrian first lap of 72 seconds. Be a little quicker on this second lap. Gavin Thompson, perhaps a reluctant early leader. He's looking up at the screen. Still very warm, in case we haven't mentioned that here at the MCG. The last two, 3 days have been very warm indeed, and not exactly the sort of weather that most people would want to run at 10,000 metres, even at the time of night that we have here. It's 8 o'clock. But 69 lap there for Gavin Thompson. As I said, he's just getting things moving along a little bit, which is good to see. But this is a very comfortable pace for all of the athletes.
You just saw the shot there of that packed MCG stadium. Still a little bit stunned by one of their favourites, Craig Mottram, falling in that 1,500 metres and not able to take part in the race in the manner which they expected him to do. Gavin Thompson running along 69 second pace. That's about the same as his personal best for 10,000 metres. So I think that's wise. 2:55 for the first 1,000 metres. Gavin Thompson leading them along and gradually picking up the pace, and eventually he'll certainly have some company. And as I say that, he's got company.
Well, this is the man who I think most people would have put down as the one to beat, Boniface Kiprop. As I mentioned, just 20 years of age, and he's had one or two battles over the last two, 3 years with Fabiano Joseph from Tanzania. He's wearing 209.1 just behind him there in second place. They're both just 20 years of age, as I said. Kiprop just doesn't have the, or so far anyway in his career, hasn't just had the ability to hang in there right to the very end. And even when he hasn't quite had the pace to beat the best in the world, the Bekelis and the rest of them. But this could be a race he may well win. Remember what happened in Manchester 4 years ago, Brendan? We had a cracking race there, which Wilberforce Talela eventually won, but three athletes finished within 3/10 of a second. It was a phenomenal 10,000 metres, a fairly quick time as well, a real burn-up over the last two, three laps, and I'm sure that will perhaps might be in Kiprop's mind. He won't quite want that to happen, as I said, but you never know.
Yeah, you said he wasn't quite on the level of Bekele, but there's nobody's on the level of Bekele. And the fact of the matter is, this young man's 20 years of age. He's got a lot of time ahead of him. I imagine we'll see him in the World Cross Country Championships in a week's time. But for the moment, he's busy running at his own comfortable pace, spending a lot of time looking up at the screen to see what's going on. And now he's got company in the form of number 2086. That's Patrick Nyangero of Tanzania. They're obviously working together as a team, and genuinely sharing the pace around is a good thing to do in this 10,000 metres.
Last round of the javelin now. William Hamlin-Harris of Australia, who really did improve his best performance in the last round, so somebody else to try and challenge Nick Nealon's lead. Well, it's around about the same place as the javelin landed in the last round. So I wonder if he's managed to squeeze out a couple of extra centimetres. Remember, Nick Nealon of England still leading 80 metres 10. And there are only two more throws to go. One is Nick Nealon himself, because the best goes last in the last round. And Oliver Zubak, this guy's Australian teammate. 79-48, it was close. But Harris still in second place. Just Oliver Zubak to go now to prevent England winning a gold medal in the MCG. Zubak in third place at the moment. Technically, that was not good. A gutsy throw, but that means that Nick Nealon is the Commonwealth Games champion. My goodness. I'm not sure I actually believed I would be saying that before this competition started, but I'm very happy for him. Nick Nealon still, of course, has a throw. That guy went crashing to the ground there. Didn't hurt his throwing arm. But that is just over 75 metres. And Nick Nealon, I can confirm, is the champion. 77-16. Zubak picks up the bronze medal.
Well, Boniface Kiprop, number 21-47. Happy to lead. He's running very, very comfortably. He's running about a pace which would take him the time about 2 minutes outside his personal best. So he's got no problems with this at all. But he is the ninth fastest 10,000 metre runner of all time, a personal best of 26 minutes and 39 seconds. And when you think that, the British athlete in here, Gavin Thompson, his personal best is 28 minutes and 40 seconds. So he's 2 minutes in arrears behind Boniface Kiprop of Uganda. And we'll see Boniface Kiprop, I'm sure, on grandstand, first and second of April in the World Cross Country Championships. We'll also see Kenenisa Bekele. We'll see the might of Ethiopia taking on those athletes from Kenya. There won't be many athletes who double up here in the championship, but Boniface Kiprop of Uganda could be one of those.
I think that's a point worth making, Brendan, about the selection for the Kenyan team, and perhaps one or two others as well. And Gavin Thompson here for England. I don't think there were too many people would have fancied coming to both the Commonwealth Games and the World Cross Country Championships in Japan, and certainly the Kenyans have picked the team. They brought one or two people here, the likes of, I think Ben Limo is certainly going, but he'll be in the shorter event at the World Cross Country Championships, and I think Augustine Chogi, who won the gold medal in the 5,000 also, but certainly has affected this Commonwealth 10,000 metre field. But Kiprop is a world-class athlete, as Brendan was saying, and so are one or two behind the Kenyans who are here. Kipengeno just on the inside, on his shoulder, Paul Langat. That's the order they finished in at the Kenyan trials, second and third there. And the times that they were running, Paul Langat, his personal best is down to 29 minutes and 1 second. And of course that's at altitude at Nairobi, so really gives no indication at all of how quick he can go at this distance somewhere here like Melbourne. So he's a little bit of an unknown quantity in second place at the moment.
The last time they saw a class 10,000 metre race here was the Olympic Games in 1956, when the great Vladimir Kutz won the 5,000 metres and the 10,000 metres. And that 10,000 metre race here in the MCG between Vladimir Kutz and Gordon Pirie was one of the most fantastic races of all time. It's been well described in many books that I've read about it, and basically they just ran each other into the ground, and eventually, with about four or five laps to go, Vladimir Kutz ran away from Gordon Pirie and destroyed him, and Pirie didn't even finish second. So this was a fantastic arena. They were a great Games in 56. Pirie came back after that 10,000 metres and came back and finished in second place behind Kutz in the 5,000 metres, but he was trying so hard to destroy him in the 10,000 metres, he destroyed his own chances. And here we are, 50 years on, and the African dominance has come in those years. In the 50s it was Europe, it's in 2000 it's now the Africans that dominate distance running.
Well, the challengers have come and gone, and Nick Nealand is the Commonwealth Games champion. I wonder if he can finish off with something a bit special here. A big roar from the crowd, and it's pretty useful. That will be around 80 metres again, and a first championship medal for 34-year-old Nick Nealand. I know Steve Backley, who's sitting behind us here and working for BBC Radio, will be absolutely delighted for this guy. Played second and third fiddle to the likes of Mick Hill and Steve Backley in Great Britain for many, many years. Hasn't given up, has continued to train, holds down a full-time job, and has taken up high jumping as well. Well, Nick Nealand, Commonwealth champion, how about that? And only two throws in the whole competition over 80 metres, and they both belong to Nick.
Well done to Nick Nealand. Gold medals for the England team, rather scarce, but a surprise one there. Well, in this 10,000, things have finally started to warm up a little bit. We had just very briefly Fabiano Joseph moved to the front, and then he was in the front for about 300 metres, and then all of a sudden, Boniface Kiprop decided that's the time I want this race to start moving along, and you can see the effect he's had. He's just thrown in a pretty quick lap there, and we've already reduced the field down to probably four or five contenders, but they're all strung out behind him, and he's really moving a bit quicker now. The two Kenyans, though, have done very well just to cover all the moves. Kipengeno in second place, and then just on his shoulder there, Paul Langard, just giving his teammate a bit of a nudge almost to say, go on, if you want to keep this moving, go at the front and make sure that Kiprop doesn't slow down. And just moving up onto the shoulder of Kiprop, he knows he's there, he knows, he must know that he hasn't broken away. But this, I would think this would be his plan anyway, Brendan, that Kiprop knows that perhaps, he said he's the fastest man in the field, then he will have looked at the people in this race and thought, I think I can run away from them.
I think that's exactly what he's trying to do. 14 laps to go in the men's 5,000 metres in the last couple of laps. A 62-second lap there. And he would expect a little bit more damage to be done with a 62-second lap at this stage in the 10,000 metres. But he's had a very strong response from both of the Kenyan athletes, Kipengeno and Langat. They've both responded really well to that form. And then, but suddenly gaps are beginning to open behind them. So three of them are breaking clear. And it's Boniface Kiprop of Uganda, Paul Langat of Kenya, and Jeffrey Kipengeno of Kenya. The three of them now beginning to just open a few yards on the Tanzanian in fourth place.
Well, Kiprop doing the work at the front. But he's got company there. Paul Langat now just easing alongside him, and looks as though he wants to make this pace continue. Must be feeling good, 23-year-old. As I said, haven't really seen him too much on the track circuit, although he has raced in the UK on the roads this last year or so a fair bit. A 64 lap there, and they really are shifting along at the moment.
The last two laps, 62 seconds, 64 seconds. And when that happens in the early stages of the 10,000 metres, you would expect bigger gaps to be opening, but they're certainly not. There's still four athletes in contention. Fabiano Joseph of Tanzania has just moved back to the group. And to move back to a group after you've been dropped a little, to do it when they're traveling at this speed is pretty impressive. He's the world half marathon champion. He's an outstanding roadrunner. He's a very strong young man, but he's done extremely well there as they move through 5,000 metres, 14 minutes and 2 seconds. And you would bet that the second 5,000 metres would be an awful lot quicker than that one.
Well, the gaps are large now, not at the front, but with that injection of pace, we had 1,000 metres of 2:44, and then the last one was 2:41, and that really is quick running. That's, well, if they'd all been running at that pace, they would have been under 27 minutes. And you can see the damage that it's done down the field. That's Dixon Marwa from Tanzania, just having a look down, and then right at the back, Gavin Thompson still in contact with this group at the back of the field.
Well, I just watched it there, Steve, through 5,000 metres. Gavin Thompson running 14 minutes and 20 seconds for the first 5,000 metres. And that's personal best time for him. His best is 28 minutes and 40. If he can respond and increase the pace like the athletes at the front are doing, if he can stay with the New Zealander H, then he's going to bit of a chance of going close to his personal best. And when you come to an event like this, if you can possibly do a personal best in a distance race, then you can count yourself as though you've done really well. So Gavin Thompson from Crawley Athletic Club, 14:20 for the first 5,000, keeping going well.
So Boniface Kiprop in the lead. Then the two Kenyans, Kipengeno and Paul Langat, and Fabiano Joseph of Tanzania. So one from Uganda, two from Kenya, one from Tanzania. As I said, Kiprop and Joseph know each other very well indeed, but they don't know the two Kenyans at all well. Kipengeno now takes up the lead. That lap there, the slowest we've had for a little while, 68 seconds, and maybe the Kenyans just feeling as though, well, we like that sort of pace. We like to keep it moving along. Kipengeno and Langat certainly working together. As soon as one has looked as though he's going the front, the other has followed, and that's what we have at the moment. Kipengeno ahead of Langat, and then behind them, Kiprop and Joseph.
Well, I've been delighted by the Kenyan performances, and I'm really impressed with Kip Kaino's plan for the future of Kenyan distance running, because he's decided that if the big name athletes don't want to represent Kenya, then they'll pick the younger ones. And they've picked the younger ones for here, and they've done really, really well. The big names aren't here, but they've gone away with the medals. They've won the medals, and that's exactly what it's all about. And if they can start to control their athletes a bit more strongly, because they are the best distance runners in the world. At the moment, Ethiopia has the edge because their athletes are much better controlled than the Kenyans. But when they control them, then they'll be battling out with Ethiopia for all the medals in all the long distance races, in the Olympic Games and in the World Championships.